We all think about the nutrition we need in our own diets time and time again. At least, I certainly hope that the majority of you out there do. Are you getting enough iron? How about protein, vitamins, and other minerals? Well, these very same questions can be posed to your plants. After all, your backyard and garden companions are living things like you and me, needing nutrition and sustenance to survive. Growing happy, healthy plants is not always easy. Appearance, discoloration, and other symptoms each send a message about vegetation health and how it can be balanced by the use of nutrients, which is not unlike managing our own health in some ways. I'm Dr. DeBusk, and this video will go over the essential elements and factors that affect them. According to Epstein, 1972, the two principal criteria by which an element can be judged essential to any plant are as follows. 1. An element is essential if the plant cannot complete its life cycle, forming viable seeds, in the absence of that element. 2. An element is essential if it forms part of any molecule or constituent of the plant that itself is essential in the plant. For example, nitrogen is an integral part of proteins, and magnesium is in chlorophyll. Just because an element is in the plant does not mean it is essential, because plants indiscriminately take up a variety of materials and water. There are 17 essential elements required by most plants for normal plant growth and development. The three major elements used by the plants are carbon from carbon dioxide and hydrogen and oxygen from water. In addition to carbon, hydrogen, and oxygen, 14 other essential inorganic nutrients are required for plant growth and are obtained from the soil. Macronutrients are chemical elements that are required in large amounts for normal growth and development of plants. The primary macronutrients include nitrogen, phosphorus, and potassium. Primary macronutrients are required in large amounts, and soils are commonly deficient in one or more of them. Beside carbon, hydrogen, and oxygen, nitrogen is the most important element in growing vegetative tissue. Nitrogen is one of the most widely used elements for plant nutrition. Nitrogen is taken up by the plant as nitrate, NO3 negative, or ammonium, NH4+, and is used by the plant to make chlorophyll, amino acids, proteins, and nucleic acids, DNA and RNA. Vegetative growth is promoted by nitrogen fertilization. If applied improperly, this can result in delayed maturity, leading to a reduction in crop yields. Deficiency symptoms include stunted growth and/or yellowing of leaves or chlorosis, which is the result of poor chlorophyll development or destruction of chlorophyll caused by mineral deficiency or pathogen attack. Chlorotic symptoms begin on the older leaves located at the lower portion of the plant and then progressively spread throughout the plant as the deficiency becomes worse. Nitrogen is highly soluble in water and very mobile, so it can be lost from the soil by leaching, by runoff, and by being tied up on soil colloids, or by being taken up by the plant. Phosphorus is used for protein and nucleic acid, DNA and RNA, synthesis, and energy transfer processes in plants involving adenosine triphosphate, ATP, and adenosine diphosphate, ADP. Deficiency symptoms include dark green leaves with a purplish color on the underside and stunted plants. Phosphorus is mobile in the plant and moves from older to younger leaves when a deficiency exists. Potassium is used in many enzymatic reactions in the plant and is involved in protein synthesis and growth in meristematic tissues. Potassium is very mobile and thus is subject to leaching in sandy soils. Unlike nitrogen and phosphorus, which are used to produce compounds for plant growth, potassium is found in plant tissues in soluble inorganic salts. Potassium-deficient plants have marginal burning of leaves, speckled leaves, and leaf curling, thereby reducing their size. Potassium deficiency typically occurs on older leaves and progresses to the younger leaves. When plants are deficient in potassium, an accumulation of high levels of water-soluble nitrogen is found in the leaves, which may be responsible for the observed necrosis. Secondary macronutrients are needed in much lower amounts than primary macronutrients. In fact, they are typically required in trace amounts and are not generally deficient in soils. The secondary macronutrients are calcium, magnesium, and sulfur. Calcium is involved in a number of physiological processes in plants, including cell division, cell growth, cell wall formation, and nitrogen accumulation. Plants that are deficient in calcium have fruits with blossom end rot, that is, the bottom portion of the tomato fruit rots or turns brown or black. Calcium deficiency symptoms appear initially as localized tissue necrosis, leading to stunted plant growth, necrotic leaf margins on young leaves or curling of the leaves, and eventual death of terminal buds and root tips. Since it is an immobile nutrient, deficiency begins with the younger leaves. Magnesium is an integral part of the chlorophyll molecule and is also required for the formation of fats and sugars. It is highly mobile in plants, and deficiency symptoms typically occur in older leaves with yellowing between the veins. Later, these deficiency symptoms move to the younger leaves. Sulfur is involved in flavors in plants and is also a component in vitamins and amino acids. The main deficiency symptom is chloroptic foliage. Micronutrients are chemical elements that are essential for normal plant growth and development, but they are needed in much smaller amounts than macronutrients. Micronutrients that are essential for normal plant growth and development are iron, manganese, molybdenum, copper, boron, zinc, nickel, and chlorine. Boron is highly mobile in the plant and is involved in cell division, flowering, fruiting, and a variety of other physiological processes in plants. Deficiency symptoms are death or malformation of the terminal bud, which leads to multiple bud break. The young leaves on these shoots become thick and chlorotic. Iron is a component of a wide range of enzymes and is involved in the synthesis of chlorophyll. Iron is immobile in the plant, and thus deficiency symptoms show up as interveinal chlorosis in younger leaves first. Molybdenum is involved in protein synthesis and is required for nitrogen reduction in some plants. Cereals, grasses, and vegetables exhibit deficiency symptoms in molybdenum-deficient soils. Plants deficient in molybdenum turn pale yellow and the leaves roll up. Manganese has a pivotal role in chlorophyll synthesis and is important in the activation of enzymes. Manganese deficiency is similar to iron deficiency, as interveinal chlorosis is observed in the younger leaves. Zinc has a role as an enzyme activator. Deficiency symptoms typically occur in soils that are high in phosphorus. Typical symptoms of zinc deficiency are reduced leaf size and internode length, resulting in a rosette appearance. And interveinal chlorosis may occur in younger foliage. Copper is important for chlorophyll synthesis and acts as a catalyst for a variety of enzymatic reactions. Younger leaves show interveinal chlorosis, terminal leaves and buds die, resulting in stunting of the plant. Although deficiency symptoms are typically rare, the visual effects of chlorine are stunting, chlorosis, and some necrosis. Typically, there are excessive amounts of chlorine, which cause more problems than a deficiency. Nickel is a component of some plant enzymes, most notably urease, which metabolizes urea nitrogen into usable ammonia within the plant. Without nickel, toxic levels of urea can accumulate within the tissue, forming necrotic lesions on the leaf tips. Prior to applying fertilizers, a soil test should be conducted to determine which nutrients are present in the soil. The soil test can be done either by a commercial laboratory or by the grower. To obtain a proper sample for analysis, the tester takes multiple samples over the entire field and combines them. After the results of the soil test are received, the soil temperature, CEC, and pH must be considered because they determine the availability of nutrients in the soil. For example, calcium, magnesium, manganese, copper, zinc, iron, and boron are typically available to plants when the soil pH is between 6 and 6.5. However, in alkaline soils, boron, manganese, and iron are not available. Cation exchange capacity, CEC, is the measure of total exchangeable cations a soil can hold. The CEC of a soil is used as an index of soil fertility. Many essential elements carry positively charged ions called cations. They include potassium, calcium, magnesium, copper, iron, manganese, and zinc. When soils are highly fertile, they typically have large surface areas that can attract and hold nutrients. Soils that are rich in organic matter have a high CEC and thus can hold a large amount of cations. Soil pH is the measurement of alkalinity or acidity in the soil based on the hydrogen ion concentration. This is based on a scale from 0 to 14. 7 is neutral, values above are alkaline, and values below are acidic. Values change by a factor of 10 for each full point on the scale. For example, a pH of 6 is 10 times more acidic than 7, and a pH of 5 is 100 times more acidic than at pH 7. Most plants grow best at pH 5 and 8.0. However, some evergreen ornamentals require acidic soil for maximum plant growth. A variety of factors affect pH, such as the amount of rainfall, whether the soil has good or poor drainage, and which crops have been grown at that location over the previous seasons. The hydrangea has blue flowers in acidic soils and pink flowers in alkaline soils, or basic soils. This plant is sometimes called the litmus paper plant because it is so sensitive to pH. Most soils require the addition of limestone to neutralize acidity and to supply adequate amounts of calcium for plant growth. As the soil becomes more acidic, there is a decrease in the availability of nutrients, thereby limiting their usefulness to plants. It is key to adjust the soil pH to meet the specific needs of the plant that you are growing, and to be able to do so, it is important to have a soil test, which tells you the pH of the soil and the amounts of nutrients found in it. When lime is needed, as determined by a soil test, it should be applied several months ahead of planting time, if possible. In a vegetable or flower garden, it is good practice to apply lime at the end of the growing season because soil pH will not change quickly after lime has been applied. Little limestone needs to be applied to raise the pH of a sandy soil by 1 pH unit. However, more limestone is necessary to modify the pH in clay soils containing large amounts of organic matter. No matter how much lime is applied, it should be incorporated into the soil thoroughly because the more completely the limestone is incorporated, the more quickly the pH will change. Hydrated limestone typically works more rapidly to change the soil pH, but ground limestone reacts over a longer period of time and is fairly inexpensive as compared to the hydrated form. In some cases, the soil is too alkaline for a crop, especially for acid-loving plants such as azaleas and blueberries. Materials used to reduce the pH of the soil are sulfur compounds such as aluminum sulfate, ammonium sulfate, ferrous sulfate, sulfur, or urea. Most acidifying materials are soluble and will quickly influence soil pH. After applying the acidifying material, it is important to wait approximately 6 months to check the soil pH in order to determine if additional applications are necessary. Care must be taken when applying these materials because if used improperly, they can cause injury to the plant. Three systems are used to determine the nutritional status of the plant: soil testing, foliar analysis, and visual diagnosis. Soil testing is the most effective way to determine nutritional levels because it provides the pH of the soil, the amount of nutrients found in the soil, and the availability of these nutrients. To maximize the effectiveness of soil testing, a proper representative sample for a specific location must be obtained. The land to be analyzed should first be evaluated and divided into sections if necessary. Within each of these sections, multiple samples should be taken and pooled to avoid biasing the sample. Foliar analysis is similar to soil analysis. The main difference between the two is that soil testing provides information on the availability of nutrients for uptake by the plant, whereas foliar analysis provides information on the amount of nutrients taken up by the plant and accumulated in the leaves. This type of analysis is used to determine the level of nutrients actually found in the plant. Plants take up an abundant supply of nutrients from the soil, and at some point, the uptake of these nutrients does not correspond to an increase in plant growth. This process is called luxury consumption. When the amount of nutrients in the plant is greater than the normally taken up as a result of luxury consumption, the nutrients can be toxic to the plants. However, if they are limited, deficiency symptoms can occur. Based on foliar analysis, the proper steps must be taken to overcome the problem found. A representative leaf sample must be harvested to determine accurately the nutrient content of the plant. A wide diversity exists between plant species on the proper leaves to select for analysis. Therefore, you should check the current literature or ask your local extension agent as to the proper leaves to use for analysis. In general, samples should be taken at 4 to 6 week intervals. Visual diagnosis is based solely on visual observation and requires a trained eye. The problem with this type of evaluation is that it occurs after there is a problem, which must be corrected quickly to avoid permanent damage. This type of diagnosis is only recommended if no other options are available. Most plants exhibit nutrient deficiency symptoms that are fairly specific for the various nutrients. In general, plant growth slows down before symptoms appear. Prior to assuming that there is a nutrient deficiency, it is important to consider if this symptom is caused by insects, disease, poor soil conditions, mechanical injury, pesticide damage, weather conditions, or other environmental or biological factors. It should be noted that deficiency symptoms are difficult to diagnose if more than one element is missing, and there may be a blending of symptoms. Therefore, if nutrient symptoms are suspected, it is important to run soil analysis prior to adding any supplemental fertilizer. In conclusion, in this video, you learned about the 17 essential plant nutrients required for normal plant growth and development and the factors affecting pH and the availability of nutrients, as well as methods used to successfully monitor nutritional levels of plants.